Welcome, everyone. We're super excited to be able to share the work of the Culture of Academic Medicine Initiative of the FMC with a broad group. We have many attendants from different places across Canada, and we were really excited. We thought 20 people would be good for a number of people signing up, but we are now at 61. So pretty exciting to share this work with you. The title of this work is situated in work on the Okanagan Charter, which is the Culture of Academic Medicine. It is the CAMI project, and it's what we want to look at today in particular is that well-being matters and matters of well-being, and also and look at from awareness to action. Many of us have felt since the COVID-19 pandemic, some of us before, some of us since, and in different facets of our lives and to different degrees that we're not quite well. And what we want to look at is that kind of self-awareness and give you some practical steps to a health-promoting academic medicine community. So today we're going to start with a land acknowledgement. We need to acknowledge and we want to acknowledge that the FMC is hosting this webinar from the unceded and surrendered territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe peoples. And we are from across the country. So I am in Mi'kma'ki, which is the territory of the Mi'kmaq in Nova Scotia. And so wherever you are from, we want to acknowledge that other people owned and cherished this land before us, and that we have a lot to learn from them in how we value it and take care of it. So we want to acknowledge the traditional owners and caretakers of the lands on which you are currently situated. For this session, it's being recorded, so we're going to try to only say polite things and acceptable things, which, you know, it's not 100% of the time. Participants are automatically muted for the presentation part. We did say it was interactive. It will be interactive, and we'll be curating questions. You'll have the opportunity at the end to raise your hand and use the raise hand function to ask questions. We encourage you to submit your questions as a Q&A function in the webinar platform. And so we will be curating those questions and asking them. And we would really like to invite people to contribute to the discussion thoughtfully, making sure that we are casting this in a positive light, in a supportive light, in ways that raise all boats. Our speakers for today, I'm the president and CEO of the FMC. My name is Connie LeBlanc. I'm from Halifax in Nova Scotia. I'm an emergency physician by trade. My scholarship is in equity, diversity, and inclusion, which I think is a big part of being respectful at work. Dr. Victor Du, I have known for many years. We co-presented 3 years before we met in person. He's the chief of pediatrics and a PGY4 resident at SickKids in Toronto, and he is a mere month from his exam and providing a webinar, which is nothing short of mind-blowing. Dr. Melanie Lewis is the Chief Wellness Officer at the Faculty of Medicine and Dentistry at the University of Alberta. The more I know Melanie, the more respect I have for the work she has done, her attention to really bringing wellness into an area of scholarship and importance for that university, work that she wants to share nationally and is going to this afternoon with all of you. And so with no further ado, I'd like to hand this over to Victor.
All right. Well, thanks so much, Connie, and thanks everyone for coming. We're so excited for you to be here. I co-chair the Culture of Academic Medicine Initiative with Connie, and it's always a pleasure to speak with both Mel and Connie because I consider them really close mentors. So the things that we want to go through today are to describe the Okanagan Charter, and specifically for us, its relevance to us as administrators, staff, faculties, and learners with respect to well-being in medicine. We want to talk about the idea of a health-promoting learning and working environment, or this HPLWE, and what does that mean, and what does it mean in our context. We always want to look at practical steps, so we're going to discuss steps and opportunities for all of us to advance Okanagan Charter implementation in medicine. And then, as Connie said, at the end, we want to have a nice discussion around collaborative next steps. So why do we need the Okanagan Charter, and why are we talking about all this? So I think all of us come to this from different scenarios and different situations. Some of us in core medical education may be faced with situations like we have here around residency programs that are on intent to withdraw for a number of reasons, maybe related to the learning environment, which isn't anyone's specific fault, but you know, with the stress of COVID and the health system and whatnot, a lot of things have come out around learning environment in medicine. You know, if you're in a clinical space primarily, there's been lots of talk and an issue around colleagues who are struggling with burnout, right? And this idea of leaving medicine and going to different places. And then some of you are or many of you may be a representative or part of different large national medical associations that interact with lots of physicians and learners. And kind of what's your role and how can we apply this concept or this idea of Okanagan Charter and a health promoting environment? So I'm not going to belabor the point on lots of the stats. Everyone's here because you know that there are high rates of burnout and distress amongst medical professionals. And there's a lot of dissatisfaction with the health system, probably rightfully so, and that people are leaving and looking for alternatives. But despite all that, I think there's hope, and that's again why we're here, because there's also increasing, you know, acceptance and recognition that there are systemic and cultural issues that are a priority when it comes to supporting those in medicine. And specifically, we've called this initiative the culture of academic medicine because it's more than just an individual well-being issue and more than just wellness. There's so much more beyond that. But, you know, there's increased public attention and funding to this. So we need a new kind of comprehensive approach to this issue. And we can't just focus on the kind of individual factors that we've done. So we need to go beyond just wellness and think about this idea of creating a health-promoting learning environment. So what do I mean when we say that? Or what do we mean when we say a health-promoting environment?
And Vic, just to go back to that, I think the whole piece around this is that we've recognized that waiting for things to get better or that the next generation is going to solve this is a very clear failed strategy. So we recognize now that we need some sort of structural comprehensive approach or frameworks to set the setting for real meaningful change, because we sat in this place now for decades where we knew the health outcomes for, you know, the folks in medicine have not been great. And now that our healthcare system is in crisis, we realize that we really need to invest in the people who are at the front lines and running it. So it's really an interesting place to be. And I think it's a real tipping point for change. So that's what we're hoping to do with the Okanagan Charter. And that's certainly why we're here today.
Well, and it's like, Mel, you talk about one of the big well-being strategies for some groups is thinking about retirement. I think our hope is that that not be what we do. So back to the you know, health promoting learning environment, what do we mean? So by this, you know, we're trying to encompass a lot of things in this definition. But when we say an HPLE, we're talking about environments that deliberately support skills, aspirations, and challenges of learners, faculty, and staff enabled through well-being centered policy, communities of connection, resources that support patient care and personal growth, which are nested within inclusive spaces. So there's a couple of really key points that we want to pull out there around supporting the individual, being able to reach their potential, talking about embedding well-being throughout, and this idea of this being an inclusive overall space.
So Vic and I tried to get this definition in a snapshot. So if you're looking for this in a textbook, it's not there because it's in Vic and I's heads. But someone said to me, no, no, Mel, what's the point? And I think, you know, when I think of health promoting environments, I think of the environments that nourish us professionally and personally. And it's not the ones that leave us like disillusioned and disenfranchised and thinking about, you know, a career in Starbucks being a barista. And I might be projecting a little bit personally, but that's the kind of environments that we want to get to, the ones that lift us up and don't leave us feeling a bit in despair.
So, you know, kind of thinking about the Okanagan Charter itself, you know, Mel, I think your slide-wise, it jumped. Did you?
Oh, I might have changed the order on you.
Okay, no worries. So from just thinking about the Okanagan Charter itself, so the Okanagan Charter was created in 2015. And if you look at the language within the charter, kind of where it comes from and what it builds on is previous, the Ottawa Charter and the World Health Organization for Health Promotion Group, which talks about this idea of, well-being as a health promotion piece and not just an individual aspect. And so already, prior to our work, many universities in Canada with medical schools had signed the Okanagan Charter, and more have since. So currently 12 of the 17 universities with a medical school in Canada have this. And why did we want to focus on the Okanagan Charter, which in its development is for kind of universities and colleges and not specifically for medical schools, is really that, you know, we don't need to reinvent the wheel. This was well thought of, well developed with countries all over the world, focused on this idea of health promotion. And so specifically, we look at the charter and we look at its kind of shared aspiration and what it's aiming for. So what we talk about in the charter is that a health promoting university and college infuses health into everyday operations, business practices, and academic mandates. And so if we think of that to practice medicine, it's the same type of idea that we're aiming for, is that well-being isn't just the side thing that you think of, but it's infused through everything that happens. And I think that well-being conversations in 2024 need to go well beyond wellness and think about things like equity and social justice, the importance of social accountability more broadly, environmental health, Indigenous reconciliation. Those things are all named within the charter and important parts for us. So the charter itself names a few different areas of focus under this one call to action, which is about embedding health in all aspects of culture across administration, operations, and academic mandates. And the five specific things they look at are around embedding health in policies, creating environments that are supportive, thriving communities, personal development, and the health services. And you'll see us moving forward that this group, myself, Mel, and others, have worked to kind of adapt those into a medicine-specific context. We've done that and also highlighted a number of important things which are in the charter, but high priorities for us, which again are around equity, diversity, inclusivity, and anti-racism, the planetary health, Indigenous reconciliation, the importance of all learners, whether it be undergrad, postgrad, or graduate students, being involved in the conversation. We really want this well-being movement that the AFMC is part of to be a collaborative approach, and that's why we've invited so many different organizations to these webinars and these discussions, because all of us have this shared focus and learning towards improving well-being. And it's really important that we take a rigorous, grounded in evidence approach with continuous evaluation. So, you know, what can we do to further a health promoting environment in medicine? And, you know, how can the AFMC Okanagan Charter Collaborative work with all of you and empower everyone to move this movement forward?
All right. One of the true reasons why I'm here as a speaker is everyone knows I can speak very fast. So we're going to go through the strategic directions quite quickly, and I'll focus on a few, but just to go back in time where this collaborative has come in a very short period of time. So as Victor said, in 2022, we established the Okanagan Charter, which involved every medical school across Canada, which at that time was the number 17, which, as we know, is changing rapidly. And each faculty was appointed an Okanagan Charter member by the dean. And the dean said that they would support this initiative, they would appoint a person to be the point person, and they would provide some resources and time for this individual to really nest themselves and try and move the Okanagan Charter forward into through all of our universities. And the one point I want to make is that although not all universities wide have signed on to the Okanagan Charter, we as faculties of medicine have committed to the Okanagan Charter. So even if you're a part of a university that's not officially a signature on the Okanagan Charter, it doesn't mean that you can't move forward with this work. So, and I think this was sent out in your package. There was a group of us that got together and we created a paper last year and was published in Academic Medicine, specifically adapting the Okanagan Charter to the realities of medicine. And we created out of the six strategic directions from the Okanagan Charter, there was five, of course, it's medicine, we had to add one, and we created six, and that's what we're going to go through next. So these are the pieces of it. So the first one was to embed health into all of our faculty policies. We were going to develop sustainable, supportive, and inclusive academic and clinical spaces. We were going to create thriving medical communities and cultures of well-being. We were going to encourage support and sustain meaningful personal development at all levels, not just for the physicians, and but that would include our administrative staff and our learners, everybody who dwells in our environment. And then the fifth strategic direction was review, develop, and strengthen faculty health services, and collaborate and invest in continuous improvement and evaluation. And in this work, that has been one of the pieces that has been missing and has been one of our weaknesses, is to make sure that we really drill this work into metrics so that we know that we're moving in the right direction, and we can also acknowledge our failures. So the first one, embed health into all faculty policies. I'm just going to go in this one a little bit of depth because I think it's super important. So these are the things that run many of our lives and are very important. So we need to look at these types of policies to make sure that they're actually supporting us and not thwarting us. So things like leave of absence policies, fatigue risk management policies, attendance policies, promotion policies, making sure that there's equity and justice in those pieces, appeal policies, mistreatment policies, professionalism policies, of course, things that are near and dear to our hearts, our call and service and vacation policies, and even email policies. I mean, that really relates to the collegiality of our environments. So when you're looking at these policies, it all sounds well and good, but how do you make sure that they're infused with well-being and they're supportive and nourishing? So we created a bit of a filter to look at these policies. So when you're creating them or you're reviewing them, these are the things that we wanted you to consider. So is the tone of the policy supportive or is it intimidating? Does the policy consider and support underrepresented and equity-deserving groups? Has the policy been widely vetted by learners, faculty members, and include these EDIIAR principles? Does the policy include elements of autonomy, flexibility, trust for learners and faculty members? We all know that when we have rigid, rigid policies, it really erodes a positive culture. And does the policy consider special circumstances? Again, rigidity is probably not what we're aiming for. Does the policy insert a barrier to mental and physical well-being? So for instance, we used to require a note if people needed excuses for medical appointments. And then when we were looking at multiple disclosures of personal medical information to secure accommodations or during appeals, not so supportive, and requiring approved absences for medical appointments rather than those being just built in and acknowledged as being important. Does the policy adhere to principles of natural justice and procedural fairness? So like when I think of professionalism complaints, we know that we can impose sanctions if it's an anonymous complaint, but we can certainly provide feedback. The name of the reporter is not required for that. Does the policy recognize the perils of the hierarchy in medical culture? We do love our hierarchy in medicine, and sometimes it gets embedded there in subtle ways. So we just have to make sure that that's not creeping in, and we do have that procedural fairness piece. And then how does this policy contribute to a health-promoting environment overall? Is it required? So the other thing that is near and dear to my heart, having been a student affairs dean for 11-some years, is even when we've created these policies, what's the tone of it in writing? You know, we run into problems with this all the time in emails, and the tone really matters. And so, for instance, you have a student who's trying to survive in medical school or in residency, and they find out that they have failed an exam, and the tone in the letter that they receive by themselves on a Friday evening says, "You have failed the MSK final exam. You are directed to contact the UME office to schedule a meeting with the Assistant Dean of Academic Affairs." So, you know, if you have somebody who's not doing very well, that could lead to an adverse outcome. And I know for me personally, I have had this exact thing relayed to me, in that I had a learner who just like happened to show up at my door like one Friday evening, was not doing very well. And I just said, you know what, this is going to be fine. And I talked them off the ledge, and I didn't even realize they were on the ledge. And then, you know, years later, he had approached me and said, you know, Mel, that day that, you know, you talked to me and you just happened to be in the office, I had a plan. I had a plan, and I had thought a lot about suicide. And if you hadn't been there, I don't know what the outcome had been. So that really struck close to me to realize about the tone of things, because if he had received this letter that said, "Dear Mr. Jones, unfortunately, you were not successful in your MSK final exam. We'd like to arrange a meeting to discuss how the UME can support you to meet course objectives and arrange an academic mentor. I think that one has that some word of tone and that it's going to be okay. And I remember being young staff, the first time I got that letter that said, Dr. Lewis, your privileges are being revoked because your charts are not being completed to the deadline. And if someone, and I was in tears, I will admit it. And if someone had said to me, dear Dr. Lewis, I know you're very busy. How can we support you to complete your dictations? Please let us know. We would like them completed by this date. That would have felt a little bit better. I would have felt more appreciated, a little bit supported, and I'm pretty sure I wouldn't have been in tears. So the next one that I just want to talk about is developing sustainable, supportive, and inclusive academic and clinical spaces. So these are some of the low-hanging fruits that we can look at our environments and make sure they're welcoming for all and supportive for all. Do we have all gender bathrooms in your academic and clinical spaces? Do you have lactation spaces for learners and faculty returning from maternity leave, areas for chest feeding, areas for pumping, those pieces that show returning parents that we care about you and we are trying to support you? Are your academic and clinical spaces accessible? The sadness in my world when I worked in learner affairs was that to get to my office, there wasn't a power door. So if you had a lower limb difference, you actually would have had great difficulty reaching me. So just looking at those pieces, you know, for learning impaired learners, make sure that we've got clear masks available and all of those pieces that, you know, are things that we should be paying closer attention to. Make sure that we have all faith prayer spaces within our medical school and our clinical spaces, and really integrating an all faith-based calendar. And I've spoken about this before because we're very good at not having important meetings on Easter and Christmas. We're not so good in terms of very important holidays like Eid and Rosh Hashanah. It's also really important for connection that we maintain our doctor and learner lounges and storage spaces, and that, you know, these things aren't nice to have. They're really crucial to allow us to have those collegial conversations and that peer support. And that leaders in human resources, the people in our neighborhoods, truly reflect our diverse learner community. We want to ensure that you know, the folks that are in our environments, they see themselves and they have the support and some of that lived experience. It's just super critical.
And Mel,
you
talked about before, I remember asking you like the situations where people would say, you know, like, I can't change my building or I can't this or that. Can you tell us a little bit about, again, as we think about the practical steps and the importance of this, like some of the ways that you've helped navigate some of those situations?
Well, so my most embarrassing one was the fact that we did not have all gender bathrooms in our medical school, which was one of the newer buildings on campus. And so, you know, it was an amazing opportunity to work with the university architect and some other folks in our space hierarchy and to understand what were the barriers to that and what were the opportunities. And in the end, it took longer than we had hoped, but we certainly got to the point that we wanted to. And then we actually had made headway across the campus. So, you know, the initiative wasn't like limited to medicine, but it helped many faculties across campus because we recognized that that was something that needed to happen, and we were going to support it as much as we could. And we realized we had lots of allies once we reached out.
And I think it speaks to the interconnectedness of all of these too, right? Because the idea that sometimes, let's say we can't change the construction right now, but the policies of how things are built matter, right? And that was never a consideration maybe how many years ago in those pieces. And so I like how, and that's one of the things we've tried to create and are things for people to think of, is this idea of making this practical and how do all of these different strategies build on each other to create that environment that allow people to reach their potential.
Yes, I know a lot about building code now. In terms of creating thriving medical communities and cultures of well-being, this one is really key. And so we've made a lot of headway across Canada in this for sure, in terms of embedding well-being curricula in UG, PG, and we're trying to make some headways in graduate studies. We're definitely behind in that area, but making people aware of the risks and the occupational hazards so that they're a little bit more adept at navigating them and being able to have some agency in influencing better outcomes. The other thing, of course, that's near and dear to my heart is making sure that somebody's driving the well-being bus, so that there's someone in your neighborhood, in your hospital, in your faculty, in your organization that has a high level position and you're sitting at some of the big tables so that you can direct well-being in your neighborhood. Because I find in medicine, everything is so in silos. You've got an amazing peer support program over in emergency medicine. You've got amazing initiatives going on in ENT, but like nobody's coordinating it and nobody's supporting it and making sure that somebody's advocating for resources for those things. Because we all don't need to like develop a peer support program if we have the infrastructure to support that endeavor, and then we can just learn from each other. But I find we're still very siloed in the well-being spaces. So making sure we understand that governance structure and that we have somebody driving it. Leadership development is key. And this is one of the ones where I'm investing a lot of time because we recognize that leaders directly influence burnout rates, engagement, professional fulfillment. And we have to give our leaders that faculty development around that. And these are super busy folks and they're busy looking after everybody in their areas. So we have to make sure that we support them and they understand the important elements that really matter to the people that they serve. And we all know formal and informal mentorship is key. Peer support has been an integral piece in terms of especially like personal resource strategies. In medicine, as we know, we are terrible at being vulnerable, and we were always, you know, taught, don't let them ever see you sweat. If you tell people you're not doing well, that's a sign of weakness. We're finally trying to break down that barrier so that folks recognize that we're just human. We are doing the best that we can. We are not superhuman, as people try to, espouse us to be during COVID in those pieces, which was really actually quite destructive. So we need to have more conversations, intercollegial conversations between colleagues on all those pieces. And then we also have to make sure that we have expertise in supporting folks during really difficult times. We know that we're all going to make a medical error, many of them, many medical errors. I could write a book. Complaints, patient complaints to the college. These are things that really unravel careers. And these are things that we need to pay special attention to support these folks so that they stay in medicine and they're thriving. And, there's just recognition that this is inherent in the profession. So to collaborate and invest in continuous quality improvement and evaluation. So I think everyone in this room, in the Zoom room today, is tired of these isolated survey that tells us that we are burnt out, depressed, and suicidal. So what we need to do is use that not as a temperature check, but as a crucial point in driving this continuous quality improvement movement. And this is the thing that we're really trying to move forward because this is something that's been missing. So again, it's metrics to monitor our academic and clinical environment so that, you know, we know environments that are really challenged and we can put some of our resources specifically towards those areas. At U of A, we do things called hotspot surveys and climate surveys to understand environments that are particularly under threat. We need to create structures that lead to sustainable impact. So having health promoting learning and work committees, and especially making sure that we interdigitate those committees, not just like just in the academic realm, but it crosses over into the clinical realm. So like in Alberta, for instance, we have to make sure that it's just not the faculty folks sitting at those tables. It's also AHS, because obviously without that partnership, we're not going to have the ability to influence to the extent that we would like. We need to support the people who are doing leadership and well-being in our places. And we need specifically to support the folks who have been designated as drivers of the Okanagan Charter and part of the Okanagan Charter Collaborative. When I go to conferences, I'm so impressed with the things that are going on across Canada, but sometimes I feel like we're all doing the same thing in our silos. So we need to create structures that we can really collaborate together and we can really harness all of our skills and strengths. In the United States, they have something called PWAC, which is the Physician Wellness Academic Consortium. So like that's something that we're hoping to do too, so that we can pool our talent and we're just not continuing to all do the same things and trying to publish the same things in the same journals. And then I love when we have metrics that go longitudinally. So if we're measuring environments every 12 to 18 months, well, when there's a quality assurance project in between there or an intervention, we can see if we're going in the right direction or not. So that's got to be something that's just not like one and done or ad hoc. It's something that we need to be doing in a continuous way. And then I just, one of the continuous quality projects that's quite low hanging fruit, which I love, is the IHI Break the Rules campaign, which is, you know, break the rules for better patient care and for better, you know, healthcare worker well-being. And that's something that happens February every year. If you go to IHI, there's a toolkit. It's super cool. And a lot of places in Canada have instituted that, and it's been amazingly positive. So just to review before we get to the discussion. So our six strategic directions that I have whipped through at lightning speed are embedding health in all policies, developing sustainable and supportive spaces, creating thriving medical communities and culture, encouraging support and sustain meaningful personal development, review, develop and strengthen faculty health services, and collaborate and invest in continuous improvement and evaluation. And I'm hoping I've sold that point to you. Because our final thoughts today, and Vic and Connie, please chip in, is that we cannot accept the current systemic hazards in medical culture that threaten the well-being of our learners and administrators and faculty members, or we're just not going to have the sustainable, meaningful careers that we want for everybody. And this is why we find ourselves in this healthcare crisis today, because, you know, in the United States, they could create an economic case for investing in physician well-being, because they knew that if you had well physicians, they were going to stay longer, you wouldn't have to pay the retraining fees, they wouldn't make as many errors, there would be less litigation. I mean, to retrain someone who's like a senior person, it's three times their salary. So in the United States, they recognize that investing in physician health had an amazing economic outcome. The problem in Canada is we kind of had to lean into that moral case. And I think that's why we lag behind a little bit. And when the United States has employed some of these systemic and structural drivers and really concentrated on those occupational hazards pieces, they've made headway. So that's what we want to see in Canada. We really need to embrace our agency and influence locally and nationally. Sometimes we feel like we have no power, but I think we have more than we think we do. And the Okanagan Charter is a vehicle to harness local organizational and trans-Canada momentum and talent. And that's why we've really invested in this framework. And you can foster a health promoting program using the six strategic directions. And, you know, I think for a lot of us, we feel like it's so big, especially the systemic and structural issues and the cultural issues within medicine. But, you know, the small things matter. You know, getting an all-gender bathroom in the medical school, it really matters. So I think it's like picking our low-hanging fruit, you know, getting some quick wins, and then building on the skill and talent across Canada. That's what I had to say. Vic, is there anything else that you wanted to add?
No, thanks, Mel. And yeah, I think for all of us, our message is that, you know, this is the general direction that the collaborative is moving alongside the faculties of medicine. And we really invite partnership, collaboration, participation into moving this forward. I hope that, you know, as Mel's saying, we're selling the importance of this idea of embedding well-being everywhere and taking a health promotion approach to where we move things from a well-being perspective. And we need everyone to move that forward, not just, you know, the faculty leader at each of the universities, that may be other organizations that have a lot of control on things like accreditation or all different pieces. And so we look forward to kind of discussion, questions from people on, you know, how can you implement this where you are? How can we help? How can we collaborate? All those pieces together. Connie?
So thanks. That was just great. You know, we hear so much about resilience, which almost gives me hives, because I think if you can survive getting in and getting out of medical school and practice, you're pretty resilient. And so, you know, you just can't do it on your own. The things that I heard that I think are really interesting is that this can start at the bottom or the top. And so we could have leaders who begin to look at policies and practices, and then individuals who kind of hitch their cart to the wagon and go, hitch themselves to a wagon and go with it. And we can provide the names of your local resources for the Okanagan Charter so that you can work with them. They do share nationally with other schools, so there is this kind of collaborative nature to it. One of the things that I think people who've been in medicine for a while, like myself, I'm pretty old, do is we work really hard to make ourselves look smooth and like it's easy. And I think sometimes having the humility to say, you know, there's a Chinese proverb that says you're like a duck. On the outside, it looks like you're smoothly gliding over the water, but underneath you're paddling like crazy. And that's how most of us live. We look really smooth on the outside and with an undercurrent of, well, maybe not panic, but certainly overwork, concerns, living things on our own, and sharing that with people, making ourselves vulnerable and admitting that is important. I want to thank everybody for having attended. We have had up to 75 people on this webinar. Beyond expectations, you've blown us away as usual. I think we have learned as much as you have. I want to thank Mel and Victor for sharing their perspective, their wisdom, the work they've done, and you for your engagement with this topic. We'll be having other webinars, and I'm just going to put in a shameless plug for See You at ICAM. April 12th to 15th, it is the International Congress on Academic Medicine, and this is important work that we do, and we'll be valuing it there like we do in the rest of our lives, and thank you for showing up.